very warm welcome to everyone again. This is the Visionaries Roundtable on Mastering New Realities. And, you know, we've seen a whole host of speakers before us start, talking about stressed assets, a word that seems to have become synonymous with the banking sector now, fortunately or unfortunately so. But two seminal changes have happened in the recent past that could perhaps change the course of how stressed assets could be resolved in the near future. One, of course, the Reserve Bank of India, Mr. Chaudhary is here. They've come out with two defaulters list. First one with 12 accounts, most of which already are in the NCLT, and the second one with about 29 accounts. The second big change that has come about is SEBI's recent guidelines that mandate any listed company to now disclose defaults that they have made within one day on loans, on bonds, on anything, which is, you know, which will for the first time enable the public to really have data on defaults, something that even bankers, you know, struggle to collate. How much recovery would banks be able to make? How many write-offs would we have to undertake before the system is revitalized? Is there sufficient capital in the system to chase after the defaulters? Is mergers and consolidation among public sector banks the answer to these problems? To answer all of these questions, I have a very eminent panel with me, and I'll start with the gentleman on my left, Mr. Umesh Chaudhary, President, CII Eastern Region, and Vice Chairman and Managing Director, Titagarh Wagons. Mr. Dinabandhu Mahapatra, the Managing Director and CEO of Bank of India. To my right, Mr. Rajneesh Kumar, Managing Director of State Bank of India. We also have Mr. Rahul Shukla, Head of Corporate Banking at Citibank, the only private banker on the panel, by the way. And Mr. Ravi Krishnan Tucker, MD and CEO, UCO Bank. First, you know, let me start with the problem at hand, stressed assets. The gross NPL ratio has crossed 10% for the first time in the past several quarters, which means, you know, for instance, of the every 100 rupees lent, 10 rupees has not come back to the banking system. What I want to ask our panelists here is, and I'll start with Mr. Rajneesh Kumar, who represents almost a quarter of the industry. Have we seen the peak of the problem yet?
It seems so if we look at the recent trend about the fresh slippages and net increase. I think it is tapering off. The insolvency and bankruptcy law, it is a game changer, I consider it, because it may be evolving, but in any capitalist system, it is a known fact that only the fittest would survive. It is a given that if there are so many businesses, some will fail, and the only way to not clog the system is let them die.
But a lot of the problems that we've seen are not problems of the recent past. They're legacy issues. So, Mr. Mahapatra, if you could also pitch in, is the worst behind? Have we seen the worst of the bad loan problem?
Today, definitely, we are in better position. And bigger accounts, almost all bigger accounts are addressed or booked. Smaller accounts, medium accounts, because of the bigger accounts, they are getting, you know, stress. Of course, not that significant. But mostly, banks, they have covered the problem areas, and going forward will be better days for bank and all industry.
What gives you the confidence?
A last June quarter result of all banks, more or less, slippages have stabilized. That indicates that they have booked all the bigger accounts. Almost all banks, except State Bank of India, because of that merger of associate banks, a peculiar situation. Otherwise, all banks, they have shown progress on that front, and going forward, it will be better days for all banks.
Mr. Rahul Shukla, since you're the only representative from the private sector banks, do you concur?
You know, our media always talks about, you know, this mountain of debt, you know, something that is going to bomb the economy and so on, right? But if you go back and take a look at, you know, the fact that when default happens, unsecured loans in this country, you are able to, you know, recover 85%, and unsecured loans, you know, you're able to recover, you know, 15%, and there is different gradation. Now, even, you know, basically on large groups where you talk about, you know, 20,000 crore or 50,000 or 60,000 crore, not all debt is NPA, because there are businesses, you know, which are running cash flow. So we have to take a little bit of a balanced view that, you know, how much is sort of, you know, really bad. Where we are well positioned, if you take a look at, you know, other economies in the region, at least, you know, we are well positioned because we have quantified basically what is bad.
Mr. Tucker, if you could come in on that as well. Do you think there are any more surprises in store?
See, as far as the NPAs for the slippages are concerned, I think leaving aside a few sectors like telecom, I think the most of the sectors, they already, which are under stress, they have been declared as NPAs. And if you really see the last balance sheet of the banks, the quarterly results, the slippages have slowed down, no doubt. But what I feel, the overall NPAs would go up to some extent in the coming quarters. But the extent would not be the extent what has happened in the past 2 years. But what is a matter of concern for the banks today is perhaps not the fresh slippages happening, but the additional provisioning which we have to make, okay, whether it is for NCLT or due to aging of the old NPAs which we declared in the last 2 years. So that is going to take a big hit for the banks, especially as far as the capital requirements are concerned. Another thing what is, I think, also affecting the overall scenario is the subdued credit growth. I think that if that starts happening, the credit offtake starts picking up. That also, in a way, helps the banks to overcome this NPA position, especially in terms of percentage. And when you grow, obviously, you are able to absorb the further losses also.
Will the cleanup have to precede credit growth? Or as Mr. Tucker puts it, will the cleanup happen along with credit growth picking up in the system?
The cleanup or the NCLT, the resolution, is the cure. What was the cause of the problem? And is that cure going to stop the growth of the country? So for the future, our learning should be that some action should be taken on a preventive basis. For example, the banks going to the government for the industry and trying to prevent that NPA from happening. But unfortunately, this NPA problem has become so large and it has come so much. Of course, it is a problem and it needed to become to get highlighted. But that should not in itself stop further capital growth or industrial expansion.
It shouldn't be a vicious cycle. Absolutely. That banks do not lend to non-performing
Absolutely.
Assets. You know, the Reserve Bank of India, as Mr. Chaudhary was also pointing out, they've given banks various tools, you know, right from JLF, CDR, SDR, S4. I mean, there's a new term every year. But yet, most of them have not really achieved the objective that they were set out to, although with the right intentions, but for some reason or the other, they haven't worked. Now we have the NCLT under the Insolvency and Bankruptcy Code. Mr. Mahapatra, do you believe that was the missing piece in the puzzle?
No, we learn from the experiences and even again respond to the dynamic situation of the banking industry. Reserve Bank of India, even our own banks, they have their own system restructuring. We all tried, but the problem was much more than our expected line. And one after another, we tried to solve the issues. Some of the accounts were addressed by those guidelines, but some of the bigger issues were not in a position to be addressed under that guideline. So NCLT was definitely an improved version. And if you see the response agent today, so far so good.
Mr. Tucker, do you also believe that NCLT will be the answer now? And could we see 2018, for instance, being the year of resolution of large stressed assets?
Yeah, definitely. We are looking forward to NCLT. And hopefully, the main purpose of NCLT is not liquidation, but resolution. And the way things are moving, I think expected, like we would have a lot of things in place. Was appointed by Mr. Mahapatra also. There were issues in the various other schemes like SDR, S4A. The banks couldn't take a call or even like say S4A. Many of the units were not coming under sustainable portion at 50%. So through this NCLT mechanism, we have that option now, even at bigger haircuts. We can take a call. And by and large, I think most of the banks have made adequate provision in their books. We have to, in any case, make 50% as per RBI guidelines. But in many accounts, we could already be having even more provisions in that. So even our balance sheet won't be hit to that extent. And I'm sure this is going to be a good effective mechanism.
But what kind of bigger haircuts? You know, the one case that we've seen resolved under the NCLT in the Hyderabad court, lenders had to, 94% haircut. Is that something that we're looking at? I mean, that's a serious matter of concern. There is a company with 900 crores of debt. What the lenders have ended up with is 54 crore rupees. I mean, is that something that we should be looking at?
No, I think that should not be taken as that's only an exception. It will depend upon case to case. It could be even, say, 50%, 60%. It's very difficult to say, but we have many good units which are running. So even I think what the bank, we have been working in various cases, at 60% haircut also, quite a few many units are viable, the bigger accounts I'm talking about.
So then let me just ask you about the defaulters list of the Reserve Bank of India, 12 in the first instance, 29 in the others. How many do you think will go into liquidation? How many can successfully see resolution?
Resolutions have to happen. I don't think there is a choice, because ultimately either it will be resolved or it will be liquidated.
That's my question.
There is no
How many
option.
Will go into liquidation?
Yeah. So, look, I think we cannot generalize or make a guess like this, but most of the problems are, you know, is in the steel sector. Hmm. And in last 6 months, the steel sector, the scenario is looking up. Hmm. And if the government spend on the infrastructure and affordable housing goes up, then there are chances that the steel sector will see a revival. But at the same time, the kind of debt, the steel companies which are under reference to NCLT, whatever be the revival, they will not be able to sustain that kind of debt. But what will happen that if we had taken them to NCLT 1 year ago, the haircut could have been as high as 60-65%. Today, with the revived scenario, maybe the haircut would be 40-35%. The debt which they are carrying in their books at that level, even at the current EBITDA margins, it is not sustainable, and write-downs are inevitable. But I think the haircut will reduce with the revival in the steel sector.
Mr. Mahapatra, but you know, what kind of write-downs are we talking about? You know, what is the kind of value being quoted by buyers?
Valuation is a relative term. If the unit is running, if the amount, is everything is in place, assets are in place, and there is a demand for the product, going forward there is a hope, then valuation will be different. If it is already dead unit, there is no demand for the product, it is a dead end of the cycle, then there will be less valuations. And I am quite hopeful most of the bigger units, if they go for, you know, 40%, 45%, 50% haircut, they can again become viable.